BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to New Arts Alive. And with me as my guest is Jonathan Lippincott. Jonathan is a critic, curator, and something new at the New Arts Program, and he's going to be involved with it. And I've never had anybody who's come in and doesn't make art. He talks about it.
Yes.
And so he actually is facilitating and setting up an exhibition. And so we're going to be talking about that. This, and you will see some of the work. So his exhibition will be in March 18th through April 28th of 2019, next year. And so it looks like fun, it really does. What I would like you to help us with, Jonathan, is give us a little synopsis, a couple minutes of what it is that we're going to be talking about today.
And okay.
So they have something to hang on to.
Okay. Well, the show is going to be two artists, Robert Murrary and Victoria Burge. And the selection of work, of their work that I've chosen, is all to deal with the landscape, but in a very sort of the landscape as a point of departure for abstract art. Which is something that I've been thinking about in a broader sense as well, but I thought these two artists were doing that in particularly interesting ways and in sort of complementary ways to each other. So their work, Robert Murrary has been a pilot his whole adult life and has seen a lot of the earth from the air and taken a lot of photographs, which he's used as the basis of drawings and paintings and sculpture. And much of Victoria's work that's going to be included in this show has to do with the celestial realm and maps of the stars and sort of the ideas about mapping. And so I thought the complementary nature of their work, one being on the earth and looking up at the stars and the other in the air looking down at the earth, was interesting. And sort of intriguing ways to look at mapping and documenting and sort of the natural world as a basis for abstraction. Because I think a lot of times people feel abstraction is completely abstract and it has nothing to do with your day-to-day reality, but I sort of feel like these artists, it gives you a new way to look at your day-to-day reality.
The element of abstraction, almost everything that's made is abstract because it's an interpretation.
I would agree with that, but I think a lot of people feel like there's realistic art and there's abstract art and they have nothing to do with each other and that abstract art has nothing to do with people's lived experience.
Yeah, I know. That's...
They're wrong, but that's a lot of people think
that's
that.
That's a difficulty we have with selling and ideas.
Yeah. Well, and one of the things that got me really thinking about this, a few years ago, there was a really marvelous show of Sargent's paintings at the Met. And you would sort of think, oh, he's a realist painter and he does all these portraits and everything. And the faces and some elements of it feel very realistic, but some of the clothing and the brushwork and the background, I mean, it feels as brushy and abstract as a de Kooning. And I thought, well, this is so interesting. It's not like this is a brand new idea or even a recent idea. It's sort of an aspect of painting that different artists have focused on to different degrees for quite a long time. I mean, at least 100 years, probably a lot longer than that.
It's pulling something that is in the background.
Yes, in some ways.
Putting it in the foreground and taking the foreground and putting it in the background.
Well, and just sort of thinking about your process and the physical process of painting and the act of painting and what, you're right. I mean, what are you focusing on? And sort of that can change. And I mean, in some ways, it seems like it was a bigger leap from really classical painting like David to Monet. That seems a bigger leap than Monet to Rothko. But I think it doesn't necessarily feel like that if you can't see the haystack or the church or the field or whatever is the possible subject of a painting.
Well, what we might do is start right off with a visual image.
Okay, sure. Jump right in.
Okay.
So this first, I'm just going to have the list with me. The first piece is one of Robert Murray's paintings. This is called Land Hope. And to give a bit of background, so he had taken different photographs from his airplane of the earth, and he was very interested by sort of the patterns of the land and the farm fields and rivers and things like that. And it's all the natural features of the landscape. There's no buildings or highways or things. And so those photographs he would then use as a reference to do very simplified and abstracted drawings. I can, maybe I'll jump ahead to another one to see if it's a little, it's harder with the lighter colors. This one can give you a bit more, you see sort of the shapes of the things. And so he started out with these drawings, and then they became a series of these paintings. This is a watercolor and pencil, an artist's paper, this one and the previous. And then he made these in metal, and he also did them as woodblock prints. So it sort of spawned out all these different
works. Yes, and each one of those show a different quality.
Exactly. And sort of the way to keep experimenting. This one is 24 by 32.
Okay.
So they're all...
Almost the size of most TVs now.
Yes, well, that's true, I suppose, So it was interesting in watching him sort of play the work across these different media and what comes out of a different, you know, the difference between a woodblock print and a watercolor painting and a metal sculpture. I can jump ahead a bit.
This is watercolor here.
This one is a watercolor.
And was the previous one watercolor?
Yes, yeah. Okay. And so this one is a woodblock print. And the shapes of these prints, and indeed in the drawings and in the metal pieces, he had created wooden templates to help him when he was cutting out the metal work to have the line that he wanted. And then he thought, well, I could use these wooden templates also to do drawings. And then ultimately he glued them all down to make the woodblock prints. So even the processes sort of kept melding back and forth and working with each other as well as the work.
This looked like a map, you know.
Yes. Yeah, some of them feel more map-like than others. I think the black and white sort of makes it more map-like.
Yeah, it does.
But
either the black ground or white ground. But
right. So this is a series of work sort of from 2007, 8, 9, but that I found really intriguing, and I've included a couple of these in different shows I've curated in the last couple of years. And the landscape and abstraction from the landscape was something you can see running through his work, you know, back into the 60s, definitely. But each incarnation of it is a little different, and it's interesting to watch someone working with these ideas to sort of keep re-exploring them and reinventing them over a longer period of time, sort of a longer arc of history. So let me jump ahead a little bit. I can show you one of the metal pieces. This is another watercolor drawing and watercolor.
Is the line drawings in, like in the one you just showed?
I'll jump back on this. The line is
Those
all
are
pencil.
Pencil, yeah. Graphite.
And then the watercolor provides all the color of it. So the paintings, this is another one with the watercolor and the paint. Watercolor and the pencil, rather.
Yeah, in the first one, I couldn't see the pencil.
And so here's, well, it depends on the color, and some of the pencil is lighter, some darker. I mean, he really thinks
He's
of these.
Got pushed down.
Well, no, but part of it is the playing with the line,
yeah,
you know, and
I
the
know.
Way you use the line and everything. You can push hard and soft. But so here's one of the metal pieces, and this is obviously somewhat more dimensional, although they're still fairly flat. But it gives you a different sense of each element and the sort of the different objects and the way they butt against each
other.
What
size is this?
These are about...
Same size?
No, a bit bigger. I think this is 22 by 30. Actually, so this is one of the smaller ones. So it's some of the...
That's about the same size as the watercolor.
Yeah, the next one, I can show you a bigger one. This is 36 by 48. And this is one of the only ones he left where it's just the aluminum. It's got a shellac on it, but it's just the raw aluminum. And so that also, the way the light plays across the dimensional pieces is really interesting.
That one looks like a paper.
It does a bit, but yeah.
I mean,
it has that quality.
Through the slide or through the image that we see, like folded paper
they have that quality.
The cuts that you have there, which mm-hmm. pencil marks, but have been cut. It's just like a pattern.
Yes. Well, and he talks about them as patterns, and I think that was what sort of engaged his eye all along, was the way that the different fields would form these different patterns or waterways or things like that. And these photographs are all based, I mean, these sculptures and paintings are all based on photographs he took in this area, but he's taken pictures all the different places he's flown in Canada and out west. And so I keep hoping he'll do more of these because I think that's a really intriguing way to sort of reinterpret what he's seen in the places that he's been. But it's a lively body of work, so it's been fun to look at all this.
Yeah, these are neat.
I can show you a couple more of these, and then we can talk a bit about Victoria. This is another metal piece.
That's on what? Is that...
This is aluminum as well.
Steel?
Steel. And these are painted. This is another painted one.
It almost looks like painted, but it looks so fluid on there, the color.
Yeah. Well, he uses, he does the painting with a sprayer, and so it can get that sort of very delicate shading, lighter and darker, and it's a little bit of a way to play up the contours, too. And some of the drawings, he did that as well, sort of playing with the slight lightness and darkness to give the sense of the dimensionality, even with a two-dimensional work. Here's another drawing. And you can see in this one a bit more of the variety of color and the sense of a sort of slight dimensionality that brings out in it. And it's interesting, he'll do the same, almost in the way that you would do a print, he'll do the same drawing but in different colors and in slightly different painting treatments, and it can make them very different. So I'm thinking in the show I'll have the same image but across different colors or different media or things like that, because I think
in
that gets
print,
very exciting.
How does he do the pencil?
Oh, they're not prints, but I'm just saying he treats the paintings.
How does he do the divisional quality?
Oh, it's just the gap between the wood blocks.
Okay.
Yeah. So in the prints, the drawing is the white space in between the shapes.
Okay.
Let's see if there's another. So that's another drawing. I think that's the last one.
Yeah, that's hard to see.
The blue is a bit softer, and you can see it more in person. So when we have them in the gallery, it'll be a much richer experience.
Yeah, I know that the color is more intense, I think.
Right. No, and these are the things, that very subtle variation of color and subtle pencil is always incredibly hard to catch in a slide or in a photograph. Jump ahead. So this is the first of Victoria's work. She started doing these very large drawings, and I can show you a detail of it, but this is what she's drawing and painting on are actually pages from an antique atlas. And so she'll take maps and then draw on top of the map sort of her own reinterpretation of the map and working in...
The authentic map or
Well, they're actual maps, and then she sort of reimagines them as she goes along. So sometimes each of the cities will become each of the stars. So this piece is 131 inches long and 57 inches high.
131 inches, that's almost 12 feet long.
Right. And
how high?
57, so about 5 feet high.
Okay.
And it's made up of 15 pages, so 3x5. From an oversized atlas. You can sort of
see
divisions
that.
Yeah. And then this is a detail. So, and I like this sort of semi transparency that happens, because that too sort of feels like looking through clouds or looking up into the night sky. So you can see some details of the original maps and the printing of that, and then her drawing and painting all happen on top of that. And so it's a little bit the original object, but then also the reimagination of the original object.
Does she reproduce the authenticity of a map? And how does she do that?
What do you mean?
Well, there's a map there that came from somewhere.
Right.
She's not using a real one, is she?
They are real maps, but what she's drawing is a different imagination of it. They're sort of the point of departure. So it's a little bit interacting with that. So oftentimes the places where she's put the white marks are places where there were cities or intersections or things happening on the map, but it kind of reinvents it in the process. And some of the pieces are not on maps, but she's often used old books or old maps in different works as sort of a point of departure.
She must go to auctions or something.
Yeah, and just secondhand bookstores, and I think friends look out for them now too. So
or looking at many books.
Yes, definitely. But you can, old maps in particular, because maps go out of date, you can find them around and about. So. Always looking for new things. So this is a different sort of a drawing and painting. And this is on starting from just raw paper. But she would do these different things where she does the different points and then connecting the points. And I like the sort of, it becomes slightly dimensional, a little bit like a Kenneth Snelson or something like that. But it also has the quality of constellations. The way constellations are mapped.
I never imagined his being flat, though.
Snelson, no. Definitely not. But just the sort of connectedness and the suggestion of it all. Yeah, no, Snelson definitely not flat.
Now, you can see the book, the paper pages.
Yes, some of the graph comes through. Yeah.
That becomes lines. They butt together.
Yeah, and they have, I mean, in person too, I feel like these have a little bit of an antique quality to them, and, you know, sort of all the sort of discoveries of ways to map things in this 1800s, 1900s.
What's the size of this?
This piece is 18 by 24.
Inches?
Yes. Inches, yes. Yeah, she's been doing much larger drawings, so it'll be interesting to think about as we get closer to the show, you know, possibly having one of those in the gallery or which pieces we want to mix together. So I can show you a couple other. This is a pencil and gesso, and about the same size, 19 by 24. And so some of them are much sort of simpler in a way, just the line and the dot and the patterns that come out of that.
This is from the previous one?
No, this is another piece, a separate piece. But they all, that sort of experiment keeps unfolding in different ways in each painting.
It's it's almost, it has some qualities, very faint qualities. Dorothea Rockburn, the folding of the cloth.
Right.
And this, I mean.
Yeah, no, it's
I could see somewhat.
Yeah, I think that makes
comparison.
Sense. Definitely. Yeah, and sort of experimenting with materials and the way you can, I mean, I like the sort of quality of that you're looking through layers and haze, and it can feel in the way that some of the color field painters or something like that. I mean, it can have this great dimensionality to it, although there's not anything particular that you're seeing, but just the quality of the different layers of color and the transparency and the opaqueness starts to make it feel like it can be a great depth and a great distance that you're looking
into. Do you feel when you see the work, because it's so small, you know, that it's like looking in the sky?
It's
the big ones might be more than
the the larger ones, because you're more enveloped in it in the way that you would be in like the color field painters or Barnett Newman, something of that scale. But in some ways, the intimacy of the smaller pieces is really appealing, because you sort of get closer to it, and it's a more of a, you know, it's a journey in your imagination in a different way. But I think that they do have that quality to them. They still feel very expansive, even at the smaller sizes. And that's sort of one of the things that's been intriguing to me about her work. I've known her for about 10 or 12 years, I think. And so seeing the sort of evolution of it. I included this one I thought was interesting, because in this case, it does have a bit more of the ground and the sky feeling to it. You sort of a sense of a mountain ridge or something like that, and then looking up into the night sky. So she plays with that to different degrees. And this is from an old map. You can see the numbers, which would have been the...
What's the size of this?
Again, 19 by 24. These are all about the same size. Some of the later ones are smaller.
Well, this is one of the smaller ones that we've seen, 19 by 24.
No, that's been about...
Is it?
They're all in that zone, yeah. But I like, again, you sort of have the suggestion of a landscape, but then it's an imagined landscape and an imagined sky. So a different kind of a mountain and more connectivity with the lines and the drawing.
But I could see this as a wall and this is a floor.
Yes, that could be really great, definitely.
I mean,
yeah, one of her last shows in Philadelphia.
That would be, you know, so you're dealing with a spatial, another type of spatial. It isn't the endless spatial.
It's, right. No, they could be really great. She did an installation in a show in Philadelphia, and I think that could be really interesting, because they do start to have a dimensional quality to them with something like that, and that you could build that out, or even just painting it on the floor on the wall.
But it's like on a shelf, as opposed to being, you know, infinite.
Right. Well, and that's sort of what's interesting, too, is the way that they suggest a certain size or scale or depth, and it'd be hard to pin down exactly what that is, and probably different people would experience that differently. But something fairly simple, but the way that it's put together can really inspire all that.
Because I could transfer qualities to Bob's with this. I mean,
That's why I thought it'd be interesting to show them together. I mean, there's certain overlaps of what they're exploring,
I mean,
what they're doing.
It's almost sculptural, you know, because he doesn't really go into Donald Judd's sculpture.
Very different. Yeah,
total three dimensional.
Right.
Of all kinds, but just enough to...
Just the suggestion, yeah. Well, I'm supposed to say, it'll be interesting. She was at a couple of fellowships this spring doing work in Ireland, and then was up at McDowell, so she's done a lot of new work. So I'm hoping to go see that sometime this summer and see what new things, because she's actually been doing some sculpture as well, so...
I mean physical?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, three-dimensional. Small size, but...
Yeah. Pedestal?
Pedestal, yeah. Right. But, so it's always fun to see what people have been up to. Get back to the studio and see what's new.
How old is she?
I don't know if I'm allowed to say. I think she's in her early 40s.
Oh, okay. She's young.
Yes, definitely.
Bob is much older.
Older than 40s.
Yes.
So I thought that was interesting, too, to have a younger artist and an older artist. And,
yeah.
To bring the work together.
Yeah, that's important.
Well, and I think it's a nice opportunity to have two artists together, because then it's sort of the way that the work speaks to each other, and it's sort of the one helps you see things in the other. I mean, it gets a little more, it can sometimes be more interesting than just a one-person show, the way they can sort of bounce off each other.
Well, they come from very because of their age difference, which I think
is
kind of neat.
Yeah, oh, definitely. Definitely. What else do we have? So then some of these white pieces I think are really marvelous, where you get, again, it's that, a bit of a depth from the density and the lightness, but these sort of become the most abstract.
It's almost, they have a crystal quality to them too. But
yes, that's true.
I don't know if that's because it's so light, the surface of a TV screen, you know.
Well, that's true, yeah, the light coming through it, definitely. But I think that the tightness of the dots and of the line on this one too, it starts to look like facets of a crystal. Yeah. No, and they have a bit of a sort of 19th century science about them, which is really appealing. Because it's all, you know, the hand drawing, I mean, it looks hand drawn and everything, but sort of scientific exploration at the same time. Another thing I was thinking that was interesting about having these two show together is that Victoria's work is pretty much only black, white, and gray, and Bob's is pretty much only in color. I think there is one black print, but so they're sort of exploring different ways of representing the land, the natural world and the landscape.
Is it this visible, visible?
Yes.
The piece itself?
The black, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So to speak, white or gray or...
Yeah, some of them are much more high contrast like this, so it really is like a night sky darkness in the background, and then white or very pale gray drawing on top of it. Sometimes that's inverted, sometimes it's a much closer range, so it's just multiple grays, like the previous piece. Oh, we're at the end. Or this isn't loading.
You can go back.
No, let me... No, I guess that is the end. Okay. Okay. So it's interesting watching her work over the years, the way that her drawing and her painting has evolved, but also in more recent years doing the larger and larger size works. You know, so they do become more something you step into.
Have you ever seen her actually working on any of them?
No.
I mean, just...
No, I actually don't think I've seen Bob doing any work either. I mean, while I'm actually there watching him do it, so... Yeah, no, I think they both kind of like to be alone in the studio.
I could agree with that.
Yeah, I think most artists would rather be alone in the studio than have someone watching them, but... It's fun to visit after a while and see what they've been up to, but you kind of need the time off on your own to really get to work. And she too, it's the work happens across paintings and prints and drawings, so I'll try to have a mix of that in the show as well, sort of seeing how that works in different media and how they do the work in different media.
So what is the basic source of her media?
Well, most of these are pencil and oil and acrylic on paper, but some of the prints, it's hard, I don't have the numbers for everything, but some of these are prints as well, so we'll have a mix of those. She's done printing with different houses in New York and Massachusetts and all sorts of different places. But each one sort of brings out different things. It's easier to see it in person than it is on screen. It kind of, everything kind of flattens out to the same effect once it's digital.
But that's the good thing about it. Because if you were going to go see the work and it looked like the screen.
No, that's true. Well, and that's the thing. It's seeing it in person is the most important thing. And for the size as well. As you were saying, everything's the same size on screen. So you can't really have the full visual experience or certainly the physical experience until you're in front of the work of art.
It's never more than just an indicator.
Right. Well, hopefully this is what inspires people to go see the real thing. It's like seeing it in a magazine or seeing it in a book. But then you have to get up and go to the museum or go to the gallery.
Well, we... Oops.
No, we can go backwards through if there's other ones you want to talk about. I mean, pieces like this where it's a much narrower range of color, it's sort of interesting what starts to happen with that. It doesn't feel quite as architectural or as quite the same kind of night sky.
Because it has different light and dark patterns.
Right. Right, so that's more
creating its own grid or whatever you want to call it.
Right.
I mean, it's not a physical line type, but.
Yeah, it's more like clouds or reflection on water. And I think those kind of the randomly occurring shapes in nature are interesting too. She did a beautiful series of prints. I don't have them in this collection, but that were based on photographs of light on water. And then she used those to make her drawings, and that was ultimately cut out in plexiglass and printed with a light ink on white paper. So it sort of has an embossing to it. But it's a very subtle shift in color and light.
Yeah, I could relate that very much to like a water, a pond or.
Right. Yeah, sort of very gentle movement of water and what that does to the light, the sunlight.
And the depth of the water.
Right.
You have other, you know.
So yeah. So. No, and I think that's what's so interesting. You know, it's ostensive, I mean, it's certainly not representational, but at the same time, it does evoke all these different feelings of experiences of nature or phenomenon of nature being out in light and shadow, being in the woods.
Yeah, this is the one that's got much more physicalness of depth, you know, I mean.
Yeah.
It's neat.
Well, in these, I mean, I've sort of always been fond of the night sky, but as I'm going up to see Bob in Canada every summer, he's so far north and there's no electricity where he's living in the summertime. So the night sky is really spectacular and you can see the Milky Way and you can see the northern lights. And so her work in some ways evokes that experience of being way out in nature and where you really do get to see the sky in a totally different way, in a way that you certainly never do in New York. But yeah, I like the ones that the sort of mountain range or sort of a sense of that.
It sort of gives you a grounding.
Right. Well, it's very much that experience of seeing, you know, if you're out, I mean, out west where there's really big mountains and you sort of have that hard silhouette against the sky.
Well, I would say it would be something down in, I don't know where I would say. Because it seems to be more of a southern Arizona type.
Oh, okay.
I mean.
Right. Well, and that's just it. Each person will see some echo of where they've been or something. You relate it to the mountains, you know.
Yeah, there's a particular form. I don't know what, but.
Well, it is, yeah, the density of white or of gray. It starts to suggest the contours of an object or different shapes. Different forms are sort of roiling clouds in a storm.
Our association with.
I think you're leaning on the, there you go.
There.
And then these have a bit more architecture to them. The drawing is, the line is stronger. And so you have more sense of forms and facets of forms.
You don't have any pulsation of the.
Right. Yeah, it's a flatter background. But it still starts to feel a little, you know, I mean, especially the denser drawing feels more dimensional. Yeah.
Have that accordion quality.
Yeah. And I mean, that, I guess that's what made me think of Snelson or even some of Frosty Meyer's sculptures, that, you know, as you move around them, the geometry changes, the shapes keep changing, and so it's flat, and then it's dimensional, and it's flat, and different things happen. I was up at Art Omai a couple weeks ago, and there's a great Frosty piece there. And it's the outline of two cubes, but as you move around it, it keeps the relation of them keep changing, and the sort of how the cubes are interacting with each other. It's kind of amazing. And just the difference of this with a much darker background and the light lines, it sort of gives a different sense of the space.
Well, totally fixes it in a whole different manner. Because this becomes associated with a ground in a way,
mm-hmm.
as opposed, you know, it's more solid.
Right.
To me.
Right.
I'm seeing it that way. Anyway.
Well, that's what I think is interesting, seeing a group of these in our studio or in the gallery, then you sort of have these different experiences and they sort of inform each other, you know, because you see the effect of having a darker background or a lighter background, the denser drawing or the more open. And I think with Bob's pieces too, the ones I've selected for this, that the way that the line, the feeling of the line can change or the dimensionality of it changes from the paintings to the prints, the sculptures, and from piece to piece.
She has very few rectangles in her.
Yes. Yeah. They're
almost
none.
Triangle-like.
Yeah.
And now this is a detail of
this big piece, yeah.
The big one.
Yeah. And this sort of, because this is of a size where it is almost more experience of like looking at a Barnett Newman or one of the...
When I look at it now, it's almost like three, besides being, you know, each square, mm-hmm. rectangle, but this section comes, and this section, and this section.
Mm-hmm.
So there's two on the side which are somewhat same in size.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have a little slice in the center.
That's true, yeah. As you look at it, it can break. I mean, it breaks in different places. Yeah. Yeah.
With that dark band down there, which kind of...
Right, which serves a bit the same. Yeah, like the mountain range at the bottom.
Fixes it to a...
And that's what I was going to say. It's a bit like the Barnett Newman with the zips. You know, it's sort of the series of experiences you have moving through one of his paintings, or some of the larger color field paintings. I mean, it has that quality a bit. And this is very varied in terms of the density, the light and the dark, how much you can see through to the original maps. And then so in Bob's as well, the different density of paint, and in this case, I think that also gives it a slightly dimensional quality. This is one of the watercolors in pencil.
It's almost like he's layering it.
Right, you know. Right.
In other words, the more layers, you get a little more intense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think working with the sprayer too, you can really work
you
with that.
You can do that.
And even, you know, if you roll the paper up a little bit while you're painting, I mean, you can sort of make a lot of different things happen. And it's always nice, seeing several of these where it's the same drawing, essentially, but then the way it's different because of the different colors and the different gradations.
And then the physical shape.
But I'm saying even if you have this exact same shape and line, the different things that the color brings out of that, if you have them in different colors, or if it's a painting and a print and a sculpture, it's sort of, you know, I'm hoping to show sort of sometimes the same image, but in three different media, and you can see how that happens, what happens with those.
they have with his, they have an off shape. Each one of them have their own shape.
Yes. Yeah.
Very subtle, but everyone has its own.
Yeah.
Those others become very transparent. This one comes through very strong.
Yes, very solid, definitely, definitely. Yeah, even with the variation in color. I think it's partially the metal, but this also is for probably more dimensional than most of them are, most of even the other metal reliefs. This passage down here with the waves and then having this mesh in there. Yeah.
That's the only rectangle shape that...
That's the most rectangle. Yeah, it's not quite a rectangle, but it's close. Closer than most of them. Yeah, a lot of them, it's just, it sort of depends on how, you know, because everything is out of a much bigger piece of land, but sort of how they're cropped and where they're cropped. You know, deciding the edge of the drawing and then which shapes you want to follow and which ones you just truncate. But they're all fairly, even if it's not a straight line, they're all fairly smooth. None of them are terribly jagged. I mean, the Catherine's Field, I mean, that's still fairly rectangular. That is a bit.
Yeah. I mean, that one is really.
Right.
Not that one, the one before.
Oh, this
the red one.
Yeah.
Or red, orange. Or, mm-hmm. Yeah, you're looking at it, you can see the darker areas or the function to a form.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that the sort of subtle variation in the color, it starts to feel very dimensional even in the 2D
shadows
works.
Or something.
Yeah. I was going to say.
It's almost like a cutout.
They do have a little bit of that quality to them.
Because they don't just happen.
No.
There's a... I don't know how to say it.
Well, it's interesting because it's sort of where, if you're doing even if you were doing a painting out in the landscape, you have to decide where the edge is. You can't paint everything you see, so there's always some cropping that happens and thinking about how that happens. And I think this, because they have mostly a clean edge and then some variety on some of the edges, but also all those shapes within almost feel like they could have been cut out and then put together. And indeed, to make the metal pieces, that's exactly what he does. He cuts out every single shape and then fits them together, and some have to be recut because as they're bent and formed, the line changes and the shape changes. So there is a little bit of that about them, definitely.
Oops.
I like the drawing in this a lot.
But that's enough. You know, it isn't square.
Or
it
isn't regular. No.
It's got a little notch taken out. And no straight line. I'm done.
Right. Well, and that's just it, sort of where are you cropping it and where is the land cropping it? Where is the form that you're observing cropping it? So there is that, I mean, it is very interactive and responsive in the way that they're created. You know, abstracted from a source material, but definitely informed by it. And then this is a much more irregular shape. The forms within that. And I like in the wood blocks too, because you start to get, and you'll see this much more in person, but there's the wood grain. You can see the grain of the wood and the sort of physicality of the piece and the way that they're made comes through, which I think
is
intriguing.
Well, it makes the surface become irregular.
Right. It gives more variety to the surface.
Some white areas or a little whatever.
Yeah. So then this is Catherine's Field, and that, you know, again, the...
This looks very not very, that's not the right word, but it does have, it's almost like it's a metal, but it's formed.
Right, right. That.
But the, that's the way the paint is applied.
Right, but right. It,
and also the, I guess the graphite marks also help that.
Yeah, the thinner line, the thicker line, it starts to suggest the edges of a metal plate and the depth of that, definitely. Definitely. No, and that's, I mean, that's what's fun to me about seeing them in different media, sort of the different things they bring out, but how the painting suggests the metal piece, and can inform the way the print is made. I mean, there's sort of that, you see a little bit of the artist process in that, I think, in that exploration. You've got an idea, but you keep turning it over, thinking about how you can sort of get at something.
We're at the beginning.
Yes. Come full circle around the room.
How did you happen to get connected with Bob?
Well, originally, my father was working with him at his fabrication space. Bob was one of the first artists to work with him the year up before I was born, so I met him early. And then the book I was writing, there was a history of the artist who'd worked with my father, came out in 2010, so I probably started spending time again with Bob more intensely in about 2008. He was teaching in New York then, so we started having lunch and talking, and I came down to visit and see his studio and see photographs. And we were talking about which picture should be in the book a bit. And then because he was in New York pretty regularly, I went and lectured at one of his classes, and we started giving talks together. We gave a lecture at the New York Public Library, and then went up to Yale, and we did something at the Philadelphia Art Museum. So we sort of, every now and then, we'd go on the road and give a talk together, because it was nice. I could sort of talk about the history of the company as a whole and a lot of the different, sort of the variety of artists who were there. You know, Claus Oldenburg, Louise Nevelson, Ellsworth Kelly. I mean, it was a really interesting mix of sculptors. And then Bob could talk much more specifically about being an artist working there and the process of that and the experience of that. So it was actually great fun giving lectures together. And then we just would see each other once in a while in the city when he was teaching. And then I, of course, started coming down here because it's so nice. So.
How about Victoria? How did you?
Victoria, someone invited me to a show she was having in New York. And I just thought the work was amazing, and she was there, and we just started chatting. And
how long ago was that?
Probably like 10 or 12 years.
Oh,
so I've been watching them for a while. Oh. And that's been, I mean, that's always been interesting to me, is sort of seeing what people are up to, the different work they're doing over time. And, you know, there's threads and themes that run through it, but they keep sort of getting a new angle on it, or trying out a different technique, or they're in a different place that gives them new ideas and new angles on it, so. It's been interesting, right? I've been writing this book about Bob that's going to come out next year, and looking at his work over almost 60 years and the different evolutions of that, but the different sort of themes that run through it is pretty fascinating. So I like looking at the longer arc of things and seeing what they're up to.
So what's the title of the book?
Robert Murray Sculpture. Oh. I thought I'd just cut to the chase, make it very simple. So it's there's a long, hopefully not too long, there's an introduction. It's sort of an overview of his career, of his work. And then I had done a few days of interviewing with Bob that we've sort of cut and edited into hopefully an interesting storyline. But it's great having him talk about the work directly. And so those are the two primary texts in the book. And then there's photographs of the sculptures, which is the bulk of the book.
Yes, it's very good that, yes, instead of being your interpretation,
right,
all of it,
right,
having that in it, yes,
right,
that's very good.
No, and I think that's a huge opportunity because he's here to talk about it, and he talks about his work really well, so it was fun to sort of have a chance to, you know, grill him and talk about, ask him a bunch of different questions and sort of explore that more. And so, yeah, hopefully the two texts have a nice interaction with each other.
Yeah, when Bob's going, experiences going back to Clement Greenberg in
right Right, right.
And who was quite not only verbal, but also writing-wise.
Right, yeah. No, he moved to New York at a remarkably good time to move to New York as a sculptor, so landing there in 1960 was kind of incredible.
No, because Bob came from the western part.
Right, yeah, he had grown up in Saskatoon in the prairies.
But now he has a place off of a lake up in north of Toronto.
In the Georgian Bay. So it's about 4 hours north of Toronto as the bus drives.
I guess it's easier by plane.
Yes, it would be much easier by plane, definitely.
But he still has a pontoon plane, doesn't he?
No, not anymore.
He doesn't?
No, he hasn't been flying. But he's still up there for the summer, so I go up to visit and then close up and come back at the end of the season.
Yeah, it's not an all 12-month season.
No, no. It's a short season at Far North. So.
Well, I'm very excited about seeing the work coming
Great.
Up.
Yeah.
And so we'll be doing what we're talking now will be in type and will be in the booklet that we put together.
Okay.
And I'll show you that sometime.
Okay.
I didn't bring in anything. No, you've never seen any of the booklets. And
well, I have the one that Jim Clark is in.
Oh, yeah. But that's
a different sort of a show, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, that would be great to see, definitely.
No, I'm glad that we could get together and I'm going to need some of the visuals as we go up.
Right, right, right.
For the booklet.
Right.
And so we can have at least some of them that are in the show.
Oh, definitely. And, yeah, we can work on all that.
And I would... do you have anything else that we haven't hit as far as the exhibition is concerned that you're putting together?
No, I think it's a pretty good overview of the two artists, at least for the work that's in the show, so we can keep thinking about that.
Well, I would like to thank you for making your journey up here today.
Yes, definitely. Thank you.
I hope that our audience will become more excited about it from seeing the tape.
Great.
And I am James Carroll, and good night.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.